Welcome to Warhammer 40k 8th edition Battle Report 20, 1850 points of Death Guard versus Ultramarines. This will be the chapter approved Maelstrom of War mission, Race to Victory, and we will be rolling for a random map deployment. Let's begin by taking a look around the board and where the objectives have been placed. So starting over in this corner of the board, we have objective marker 1 right here. In this middle 2 foot by 2 foot section, we have objective marker 4 right here next to this ruin. And then finally on this side of the board, we have the third 2 foot by 2 foot section with objective marker 3 right next to this ruin, close to the edge of the board. Moving over to the other side of the board, we will start with this 2 foot by 2 foot section, which has objective marker 2 right here next to this crater. Then in the middle, we have this 2 foot by 2 foot section with objective marker 5 right on the other side of this building from the edge of the board. And then finally, this 2 foot by 2 foot section with objective marker 6 on the other side of this ruin next to a crater. And now we will roll for a random map deployment here, getting a 4, which is Hammer and Anvil. So on a roll of a 1, 2, or a 3, the Death Guard will deploy on the near side, and the Ultramarines will deploy on the far side. And on a 4, 5, or 6, the Death Guard will deploy on the far side, and the Ultramarines will deploy on the near side. And so here's the dice roll, getting a 6, which means the Death Guard will deploy on the far side, and the Ultramarines will deploy on the near side. And now on a roll of a 1, 2, or 3, the Death Guard will begin deploying first, and on a 4, 5, or 6, the Ultramarines will begin deploying first. Getting a 4, and so the Ultramarines will begin deploying first. We will be back after the deployment. Both armies have now finished deploying, so we'll take a quick look at where the models have been placed on the board. Starting with the Death Guard deployment, going from left to right, from the Ultramarines perspective, we have the first Demon Prince of Nurgle with wings. Next, we have the Plague Burst Crawler. Then we have the Chaos Land Raider. The Plague Marines, Plague Surgeon, Tallyman, and Malignant Plaguecaster are all embarked inside the Chaos Land Raider. Then we have the second Demon Prince of Nurgle with wings. The first squad of Nurgling Swarms sitting on Objective Marker 1. The second squad of Nurgling Swarms sitting on Objective Marker 6. And then finally, we have the Warlord Mortarion. Moving over to the Ultramarines deployment, also going from left to right from the Death Guard perspective, we have the first squad of Tactical Marines, and they are within 3 inches of the center of Objective Marker 2. We then have the first Stormraven gunship. It does have the Chaplain with the Armor Indomitus, and the first Assault Centurion squad embarked inside. Right in the middle, we have the second squad of Tactical Marines, and right behind them is the Ultramarines Warlord, Rabaut Gilliman. In the back of the deployment zone, we have the second Stormraven gunship with the second Chaplain and the second Assault Centurion squad embarked inside. And then finally, we have the third Tactical Marine squad sitting within these ruins. And so the Ultramarines began to deploy first, and they also finished deploying first, which means they will go first unless the Death Guard are able to successfully seize the initiative. So now the Death Guard will attempt to seize the initiative, and they are looking for a 6, and they fail to get it. So let's go into Ultramarines turn 1. Going into Ultramarines turn 1, a reminder that the Ultramarines have 9 command points available, and the Death Guard have 6 command points available. The Ultramarines began by drawing 3 new tactical objective cards, and they drew overwhelming firepower. Score one victory point if an enemy unit was destroyed during the shooting phase of your turn. If three or more enemy units were destroyed during the shooting phase of your turn, score D3 victory points instead. Secure objective 3. Score one victory point if you control objective marker 3 at the end of your turn. And Kingslayer. Score D3 victory points if your opponent's warlord has been destroyed during this or any previous turn. And objective marker 3 is right here, currently being held by this squad of tactical marines. So going into the movement phase, this squad of tactical marines sitting on objective marker 3 will remain still. This squad of tactical marines is going to move up the board up to 6 inches. And now all 5 of them are sitting right here in the crater. Next, the warlord Gilliman, who has a movement of 8 inches, is going to move up the board to stay behind the tactical marines. And he will finish his movement right here. This squad of tactical marines sitting on objective marker 2 will also remain still. The first Storm Raven will remain in flying mode, and it will fly up the board towards Gilliman and the Death Guard deployment zone at least 20 inches, but less than 45. And it pivoted and flew up the board about 21 inches, so that now it's about an inch away from Rabaut Gilliman, at least with its base. But the hull is definitely within 6 inches. So now the second Storm Raven will do the same thing. It will remain in flying mode, and it will fly up the board at least 20, but less than 45 inches in order to reposition itself so that it is within 6 inches of Gilliman. And it will end its movement right here, and it is very wobbly on that crater, so hopefully it won't fall over. But he is now within 6 inches of Gilliman. Going into the shooting phase, the Ultramarines will start by having the last cannon from this tactical marine squad shoot Mortarion right here, which they can see through the windows of the ruin. One shot, hitting on a 3, and it misses. The last cannon from this tactical marine squad is going to shoot the Chaos Land Raider. And this tactical marine squad is going to use the stratagem Scions of Gilliman for one command point, bringing them from 9 down to 8. Use this stratagem when an Ultramarines infantry or Ultramarines biker unit is selected to attack in a shooting or fight phase. You can reroll all hit rolls of 1 for that unit for the rest of the phase. If the unit is a tactical squad or intercessor squad, reroll all failed hit rolls instead. But first, on a 5 up, do they get the command point back? And they do not. Which means the Ultramarines are now permanently down to 8 command points. So the last cannon shooting the Chaos Land Raider, hitting on a 3, and it hits anyways. Strength 9 versus toughness 8 means 3s to wound, and it gets a wound. Minus 3 AP, so 1 5 up armor save, which fails. The Death Guard are going to use one command point, going from 6 down to 5 in order to use a command reroll, in order to reroll that failed armor save. And so here's the reroll. And they still fail. So the Death Guard are permanently down to 5 command points, and the shot will go through. Which means it will do D6 damage, and it will do 1 damage. The Ultramarines are now going to use one command point, going from 8 down to 7 in order to use a command reroll to reroll the amount of damage. But first, on a 5 up, do they get the command point back? And they do. So the Ultramarines will stay at 8 command points. And now, how much damage does it do? It still does just 1 damage, but they do not waste the command point. And so the Chaos Land Raider will drop from 16 starting wounds down to 15. Now the last cannon in this tactical marine squad will fire at the Chaos Land Raider, hitting on a 3, and it hits, wounding on a 3, and it wounds. 1 5 up armor save, which fails, and it does D6 damage, and it does just 1 damage. So this Chaos Land Raider will drop from 15 wounds down to 14. Next, this Storm Raven is going to fire everything that it has into the Chaos Land Raider. Unfortunately for the Storm Raven, it is not in rapid fire range. So starting with the 2 Hurricane Bolters, 12 shots hitting on 3s, getting 8 hits and 4 rerolls. And here's the 4 rerolls. Getting 3 more hits for 11 hits total. Strength 4 versus toughness 8 means 6s to wound. And getting 1 wound so far, and 10 rerolls. And here's the 10 rerolls, failing to get any more wounds. So the Land Raider will take 1 2-up armor save, which passes. 6 shots from the Twin Heavy Bolter, hitting on 3s. Getting 3 hits and 3 rerolls. And here's the rerolls, getting only 1 more hit. 4 hits total, wounding on 5s. Getting 3 wounds and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, still failing to wound. Minus 1 AP, so 3 3-up armor saves. Passes 2 and fails 1. So the Chaos Land Raider will drop from 14 wounds down to 13. 2 Storm Strike Missile Launchers, hitting on 3s. Getting 1 hit and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll. Getting a second hit. Strength 8 versus Toughness 8 means wounding on 4s. And getting 2 wounds. Minus 3 AP, so 2 5-up armor saves. Passes 1 and fails 1. And it is 3 damage apiece. So the Chaos Land Raider will fall from 13 wounds down to 10. Finally, the Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon will fire, and it will fire supercharged shots. So starting with 2 D3 shots, and only getting 2 shots. Hitting on 3s, and both fail to hit, but getting 2 rerolls, and only getting 1 hit. Strength 8 versus Toughness 8 means a 4 to wound, and it wounds. Minus 3 AP, so 1 5-up armor save, which fails, and it will do 2 damage. So the Chaos Land Raider will drop from 10 wounds down to 8. Now the other Storm Raven is going to fire into the Chaos Land Raider. However, it is over 24 inches away, so the Hurricane Bolters will not be able to fire at all. So starting with the Twin Heavy Bolter, 6 shots hitting on 3s, getting 3 hits and 3 rerolls. And here's the 3 rerolls, getting all 6 hits, wounding on 5s, getting 2 wounds and 4 rerolls. And here's the 4 rerolls, failing to get any more wounds. Minus 1 AP, so 2 3-up armor saves, and passes both. Next will be the 2 Storm Strike Missile Launchers, hitting on 3s, getting 2 hits, wounding on 4s, getting 1 wound and 1 reroll. And here's the 1 reroll, still failing to wound. 1 5-up armor save, which fails, and that is 3 damage. So the Chaos Land Raider will drop from 8 wounds down to 5 left. The Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon, which will fire supercharged shots. 2 D3 shots, getting 3 shots. Hitting on 3s, getting 1 hit and 2 rerolls. And here's the 2 rerolls, getting 1 more hit, but also taking a mortal wound, which will be resolved after the shots from the Heavy Plasma Cannon have been resolved. But the 2 shots that hit, Strength 8 versus Toughness 8 means wounding on 4s. Both fail to wound, and rerolling, and still fail to wound. And the Ultramarines will not try to save the mortal wound from the Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon, and so the Storm Raven will go from 14 starting wounds down to 13. The last unit on the Ultramarine side that can shoot is Rabaut Gilmon, and he will fire the Hand of Dominion into the Chaos Land Raider. Gilmon is not in rapid fire range, so 3 shots hitting on 2s, and getting 3 hits. Strength 6 versus Toughness 8 means 5s to wound, getting 2 wounds and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, which also wounds. Minus 1 AP, so 3 3-up armor saves. Passes 1 and fails 2, and they are 2 damage apiece. And so that will drop the Land Raider from 5 wounds down to 1 left. And I would like to take a moment to appreciate the fact that because the 2 last cannons from the Tactical Marines that both wounded and got past the armor saves, because they both rolled 1s on their D6 damage rolls, because of that, this Land Raider is still alive. And considering the fact that one of those last cannons used a command point to reroll the damage and still rolled a 1, that's pretty unlucky for the Ultramarines right there. And so that's the end of the shooting phase for Ultramarines turn 1. There are no charges to declare in the assault phase, there are no fights to resolve in the fight phase, and there are no morale tests to take in the morale phase. And I do apologize, but we're going to go back in time for a moment, because it could potentially matter, or not matter at all. And this is why it's important to fire everything you possibly can, whenever possible. I was looking at the models and realized that this sergeant for the Tactical Marine Squad is not only within 24 inches of the Chaos Land Raider, but can see it around the corner of this ruin. And I realize it's slightly out of order, but partially to make up for the fact that the Ultramarines rolled so poorly with their last cannons when it came to damage results, and it shouldn't even be a factor at this point, I am going to go back and have that sergeant fire his bolt gun into the Land Raider. because obviously that's who he would have fired at, because that's the only target that was in range when the last cannon shot. And this is why it is important to fire everything, no matter how unlikely it is to do damage, because potentially the bolt gun from the sergeant could take off the last wound from the Land Raider. So, bolt gun from the sergeant, hitting on a 3, and it hits, wounding on a 6. And it fails to wound, but rerolling thanks to Gilliman, and it still fails to wound. So that bolt gun, it does not matter. It did not finish off the Land Raider. And while I'm making corrections about things, I did go back and look at the footage, and I have to make one other correction because this last cannon moved, which means that it only hits on a 4, not a 3. And it did roll a 3 to hit the Land Raider, which means that the 1 damage from that last cannon actually should not have counted, which means that the Land Raider is actually up to 2 wounds left and not just 1. Because of course the last cannon would be hitting on a 4, re-rolling only 1s and 2s because re-rolls happen before modifiers. And so the 3 to hit would just be a permanent, guaranteed failed hit since he moved. So I do apologize about that as well, but now everything possible that could have fired has, as far as I know at this point, everything has been done correctly in terms of proper hit rolls. So I do apologize about that, but the Land Raider is still alive, and it is still alive with 2 wounds left, not 1. And so, taking a look at the tactical objective cards, thanks to that Land Raider surviving, the Ultramarines failed to complete overwhelming firepower. They did, however, successfully secure objective 3 for 1 victory point. And of course, they have not completed Kingslayer yet. But the Ultramarines are going to hold on to both overwhelming firepower and Kingslayer for at least one more turn. And so at the end of Ultramarines turn 1, the score currently sits at 1 victory point for the Ultramarines and 0 victory points for the Death Guard. So going into Death Guard turn 1, a reminder that the Death Guard have 5 command points left and the Ultramarines have 8 command points left. And so the Death Guard started by drawing 3 new tactical objective cards, and they drew Kingslayer, score D3 victory points if your opponent's Warlord has been destroyed during this or any previous turn. Big Game Hunter, score 1 victory point if at least 1 enemy unit with a wounds characteristic of 10 or more was destroyed during this turn. If at least 1 enemy unit with a wounds characteristic of 20 or more was destroyed during this turn, score D3 victory points instead. And Disgusting Devotions, whilst this tactical objective is active, keep a tally of the number of successful, disgustingly resilient rolls you make in each turn. Score 1 victory point if you successfully made at least 7 disgustingly resilient rolls during this turn. And because most disgustingly resilient rolls are taken in your opponent's turn, I would assume it means game turn, not player turn, when it says this turn, but I'm not quite sure. We will see if that actually matters or plays a role. But I am going to assume, because otherwise I feel it would be way too difficult to make 7 disgustingly resilient rolls in a single one of your own player turns. But we'll see. So going into the movement phase, this squad of Nurgling Swarms is going to remain still. This squad of Nurgling Swarms will also remain still. Mortarion is going to move up to 12 inches up the board. And he will also declare an advance. So here's Mortarion's advance roll and gets 4 extra inches, so he will have 16 inches of total movement. And so Mortarion will end his movement right here. Next, this Plague Burst Crawler is going to move up to 9 inches up the board, and it will finish its movement right here. Now, all of the models embarked inside of the Chaos Land Raider are going to disembark, and they will all disembark right here. Now, they all will move up the board up to 5 inches, starting with the Plague Marines, then moving on to the Malignant Plague Caster, then the Plague Surgeon, then the Tallyman, since they technically have to be done separately, but we will come back after all 4 units have moved. And they will all finish their movement right here. Now that the Chaos Land Raider is down to 2 wounds, it has a movement of 3 inches, and so it will move up to 3 inches over in this direction to get a better angle on the Storm Raven that lost a wound in the the Ultramarines' turn, thanks to a mortal wound from its own twin heavy plasma cannon. And so it will finish its movement right here. Now, this Demon Prince is going to jump up the board, up to 12 inches, to stay behind the Plague Marines. And it will finish its movement right here. Finally, this Demon Prince of Nurgle with Wings is going to jump up the board up to 12 inches to also be behind the Plague Marines. And he will finish his movement right here. Going into the psychic phase, Mortarion is going to attempt to manifest Miasma of Pestilence onto himself and Smite onto this Storm Raven, which is down to 13 wounds because it is within 18 inches and it is the closest visible enemy unit. Starting with Miasma of Pestilence, which has a warp charge of 6 and he gets it with a 9. So it will go off, so now the Ultramarines have to subtract 1 from hit rolls against Mortarion until the start of the next Death Guard psychic phase. And now for Smite, which needs a 5, and he gets it with a 6. And so it will do D3 mortal wounds, and it will do 2 mortal wounds. And the Ultramarines are going to use the stratagem, Armor of Contempt, for 1 command point, bringing them from 8 down to 7. Use this stratagem when an Adeptus Astartes vehicle suffers a mortal wound, roll a D6 for that mortal wound and each other mortal wound inflicted on this model for the rest of the phase. On a 5 up, that mortal wound is ignored and has no effect. But first, do the Ultramarines get the command point back on a 5? And they do not, so the Ultramarines are now permanently down to 7 command points. But they get to roll a dice for each mortal wound, and on a 5 up they ignore it, and they will ignore one of them, taking just 1 mortal wound. So this Storm Raven will fall from 13 wounds down to 12. Now, the Malignant Plague Caster will attempt to manifest Putrescent Vitality onto the Plague Marines, and he will also attempt to manifest Smite onto this fully healthy Storm Raven. So starting with Putrescent Vitality, which has a warp charge value of 6, and he gets it with a 10. So the Plague Marines, until the start of the next Death Guard psychic phase, will have +1 strength and +1 toughness. And now for Smite, and he gets it with an 8. It will do D3 mortal wounds, and it will do 3 mortal wounds. So the fully healthy Storm Raven will fall from 14 starting wounds down to 11. So now this Demon Prince will attempt to manifest Smite onto this Storm Raven. Smite has a warp charge value of 5, and he fails with a 3. But the Death Guard will use 1 command point going from 5 down to 4 in order to re-roll the 1. But first, the Death Guard, now that the Tallyman is out, need to roll 2 dice, and if it equals a 7, and it does, they get the command point back. So the Death Guard will remain at 5 command points, but they cannot use any more command rerolls for the rest of the psychic phase. And here's the reroll of the 1, and they get a 6, so it will successfully go off. And it will do D3 mortal wounds, and it will do another 2 mortal wounds. So this Storm Raven will fall from 11 wounds down to 9. Finally, this Demon Prince of Nurgle, this one right here, the farther one away from the Plague Burst Crawler, will now fire Smite into this Storm Raven because it is the closest visible enemy unit. Smite has a warp charge value of 5, and it will go off with an 8. It will cause D3 mortal wounds, and it will cause another 3 mortal wounds. So the Storm Raven will fall from 9 wounds down to 6. Going into the shooting phase for Death Guard turn 1, a reminder that Mortarion advanced, and so he is not able to fire this turn. And so the Death Guard will begin with the Chaos Land Raider, which is down to 2 wounds, and it will fire its Combi Bolter and its Twin Heavy Bolter into this squad of Tactical Marines, and then the Land Raider will fire its 2 Twin Last Cannons into this Storm Raven, which is now down to 6 wounds. Starting with the Combi Bolter, and it is not in rapid fire range, so 2 shots, hitting on 5s, rerolling 1s, getting 1 hit and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, getting 2 hits. Strength 4 versus toughness 4 means 4s to wound, and failing to wound. Now for the Twin Heavy Bolter, 6 shots, hitting on 5s, rerolling 1s, and getting 4 hits. Strength 5 versus toughness 4 means 3s to wound, and getting 4 wounds. -1 AP, but thanks to the crater that the Tactical Marines are sitting in, 4 3-up armor saves. Passing 1, failing 3. And so all 3 regular Bolt Gun Marines will be removed, leaving just the Last Cannon and the Sergeant. Now the 2 Twin Last Cannons into the Storm Raven. Because the Storm Raven is still in flying mode, 4 shots hitting on 6s, rerolling 1s, getting 3 definite misses and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, still failing to hit. So now the Plague Burst Crawler is going to fire its heavy slugger into the tactical squad that is now down to just the sergeant and the last cannon. And it will fire its two entropy cannons and its Plague Burst Mortar into the Storm Raven that's down to 6 wounds. And the Death Guard are also going to use the stratagem Blasphemous Machines for 1 command point, taking them from 5 down to 4. Use this stratagem just before a Death Guard vehicle attacks in the shooting phase. Until the end of the phase, that vehicle can ignore the penalties for moving and firing heavy weapons or for advancing and firing assault weapons. And obviously, that will be the Plague Burst Crawler that uses this stratagem. But first, thanks to the Tallyman, rolling 2 dice, and if it equals a 7, they get the command point back. And it does not, so they are permanently down to 4 command points. Starting with the Heavy Slugger, 4 shots. Hitting on 4s, rerolling the 1 thanks to the Demon Prince, but 3 definite misses. And here's the reroll, which does hit. Strength 5 versus Toughness 4, wounding on a 3, and it wounds. Minus 1 AP from the weapon, but plus 1 thanks to the crater, so 1 3 up armor save, which passes. 2 entropy cannons, hitting on 5s, and both fail to hit. And the Death Guard are going to use 1 command point, now that's the shooting phase, for 1 command reroll, taking them from 4 command points down to 3 in order to reroll one of those misses with the entropy cannon. But first, thanks to the Tallyman, on 2 dice, do they get a 7? And they do not, so they do not get the command point back, and therefore they are permanently down to 3 command points. And so here's the reroll from the entropy cannon, and it still misses, needing a 5 thanks to the Storm Raven being still in flying mode. Now the Plague Burst Mortar will fire D6 shots, getting 6 shots, hitting on 5s, rerolling 1s, and getting 5 hits. Wow. And the Storm Raven is over 12 inches away, so it is okay for the Plague Burst Crawler to fire at the Storm Raven with the mortar. Strength 8 versus Toughness 7 means 3s to wound, rerolling 1s thanks to being a plague weapon, but of course getting 3 wounds and 2 2s. Minus 2 AP, so 3 5-up armor saves. Passes 1 and fails 2. And the Ultramarines are going to use 1 command point for 1 command reroll in order to reroll the 4. But first, on a 5-up, do they get the command point back? And they do. So the Ultramarines will stay at 7 command points. And now they will reroll the 4. Still getting another 4, which means 2 wounds will go through. The Storm Raven has 6 wounds left, and both of these shots are D3 damage. So the Death Guard are really hoping for 2 5-ups, and they fail by getting a 1 and a 4, which means it will do 3 damage. So the Storm Raven will drop from 6 wounds down to 3 left. Unfortunately for the Death Guard, all 3 of these characters here are over 12 inches away from anything, and so the only thing that can shoot that's left in the Death Guard side is the Plague Champion will fire his bolt pistol onto the Storm Raven. So, 1 shot, hitting on a 4, rerolling 1s. Rerolling the 1 thanks to the Demon Prince, and here's the reroll, and it hits. Wounding on a 5, and it fails to wound. And so that is the end of the Death Guard shooting phase. There are no charges to declare in the assault phase because there are no enemy units that are chargeable that are within 12 inches because obviously the Storm Raven is flying and therefore only units with the fly keyword like the Demon Princes could charge it, but they are definitely well over 12 inches away. So the only unit that the Plague Marines would be able to charge would be the Tactical Marines, and they are over 12 inches away from the Plague Marines. So there's no charges to declare in the assault phase, which means once again there's no fights to resolve in the fight phase. So going into the morale phase, this squad of Tactical Marines lost 3 models this turn. However, thanks to being an Ultramarine, the sergeant, who's still alive, has a leadership of 9, which means it's impossible to fail a morale check after losing 3 guys. So they do not have to take a morale check. So taking a look at the tactical objective cards, the Death Guard have not yet completed Kingslayer. They failed to complete Big Game Hunter since the Storm Raven decided to stay alive, just like the Land Raider did. And they have not rolled for any disgustingly resilient rolls, and so they have not completed Disgusting Devotions. And at this point, the Death Guard are going to throw Disgusting Devotions away and hope to draw something much better and much less complicated to complete. And so at the end of Death Guard turn 1, the score currently sits at 0 victory points for the Death Guard and 1 victory point for the Ultramarines, and First Blood has still not been achieved yet. Going into Ultramarines turn 2, a reminder that the Ultramarines have 7 command points available, and the Death Guard have 3 command points available. Also, a reminder that the Ultramarines held onto Overwhelming Firepower and Kingslayer from the previous turn. Hence, the Ultramarines draw 1 new tactical objective card, and they draw No Mercy, No Respite. Score 1 victory point if at least 1 enemy unit was destroyed and or failed a morale test this turn. If 3 or more units were destroyed and or failed morale tests, score D3 victory points instead. Going into the movement phase, this squad of tactical marines will remain still. This squad of tactical marines will also remain still. This third tactical marine squad will also remain still. This Storm Raven, the one that is still at 12 wounds, will remain in flying mode, and it will fly up the board towards the Death Guard deployment zone at least 20 inches, but less than 45. And so the Storm Raven will end up right here, definitely flying well over 20 inches, but under 45, and it is still in flying mode. Now, this Storm Raven is going to drop into hover mode, and the Centurions and the Chaplain inside will disembark. And they will all disembark right here, within 3 inches of the base of the Storm Raven. And so now, the Centurions are going to move up the board up to 4 inches. And so the Centurions will finish their movement right here. The Chaplain will now move up the board up to 6 inches. And he will finish his movement right here. Now the Storm Raven, in hover mode, will move up to 20 inches up the board. And so the Storm Raven, with 3 wounds left, will end up right here. Finally, Guillemon will move up the board up to 8 inches. And Guillemon will finish his movement right here. Going into the shooting phase for Ultramarines turn 2, the Ultramarines are going to start with the last cannon from this tactical marine squad, and it will fire into the Chaos Land Raider. And 3 of these bolt guns can see the Plague Burst crawler through this ruin right here, while the 4th bolt gun right inside of here can only see the Plague Marines. And this tactical marine squad is going to use the stratagem Scions of Guillemon for 1 command point so that they can reroll failed hit rolls. So that will take them from 7 command points down to 6, but on a roll of a 5 up, they get the command point back. And they do not. So the Ultramarines are now permanently down to 6 command points. So the 1 bolt gun on the Plague Marine. And it fails to hit, but re-rolling thanks to Scions of Guillemon. And here's the re-roll, still failing to hit. Now the 3 bolt guns onto the Plague Burst Crawler. Hitting on 3s, and of course all 3 of those hit. Wounding on 6s. Getting 1 wound. 1 3 up armor save, which passes. Now the last cannon will hit on a 3, and it hits, wounding on a 3, and it wounds. Minus 3 AP, so 1 5 up armor save, which fails. And the Death Guard are going to use 1 command point for a command reroll, going from 3 down to 2 in order to reroll that. But first, thanks to the Tallyman rolling 2 dice, hoping for a 7, and they don't get it, so they permanently lose the command point and are permanently down to 2. But now re-rolling the armor save, and it does pass. So no damage taken on the Land Raider from that last cannon. So now this tactical marine squad is going to fire the last cannon and the sergeant's bolt gun into the Land Raider. They did not move this time, so the last cannon will hit on a 3. And it actually hits this time. Wounding on a 3, and it wounds. 1 5 up armor save, and it fails. It will do D6 damage, and it does 3 damage. And so that will finish off the 2 wounds remaining on the Land Raider. So will the Land Raider explode on a 6? And it does not. Which means that the Chaos Land Raider will lose its final 2 wounds, and then it will be removed from the battlefield for first blood. This does mean that the bolt gun on the sergeant will go to waste. So now the Centurion Assault Squad, and all 3 models are within 8 inches, are going to fire their flamers into the Plague Marines. 6 D6 shots. And that is 24 shots. This weapon automatically hits, so 24 hits. Strength 4 versus toughness 5 versus toughness 6. Sorry, they did get off putrescent vitality. So strength 4 versus toughness 6 means wounding on 5s. Getting 8 wounds and 16 fails, but Guillemon is within 6 inches, which means they get to reroll failed wound rolls. So here's the 16 rerolls, which will give them an additional 6 wounds for 14 wounds total. No AP, so 14 3-up armor saves. and they only fail four of them, passing 10. Four, five up, disgustingly resilient rolls, rerolling ones thanks to the Plague Surgeon, passing two and failing two. So this means that two bubotic axes will be removed, leaving five models left alive in the squad. So now the Chaplain will fire his Combi Flamer, using both profiles, into the Plague Marines. Starting with the Bolt Gun profile, two shots, hitting on fours, rerolling ones and twos, thanks to Gilmon, getting one hit and one definite miss. Wounding on a five, and rerolling thanks to Gilmon. Here's the reroll, getting a wound. One, three up armor save, which passes. D6 shots from the Flamer, getting one shot. It automatically hits, so one hit. Wounding on a five, failing to wound, but getting a reroll, which still fails to wound. Next, this squad of tactical Marines is over 24 inches away from anything, so it can only fire the last cannon, and it will fire the last cannon into the Plague Burst Crawler, which it can now see. One shot, hitting on a three, and it hits. Strength 9 versus toughness 8 means a 3 to wound, and it wounds. One, five up, invulnerable save, which passes. Next, this Storm Raven is going to fire its two Hurricane Bolters, its Twin Heavy Bolter, and its Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon into the Plague Marines, and it will fire its two Storm Strike Missile Launchers into the Plague Burst Crawler. Starting with the Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon, and it will fire standard shots. So two D3 shots, getting three shots, hitting on fives, getting one hit and two rerolls. And here's the two rerolls, still just getting the one hit. Strength 7 versus toughness 5 means a 3 to wound, and it wounds. Minus 3 AP, so 1 6 up armor save, which fails. And it only does 1 damage, so 1 5 up disgustingly resilient roll, which also fails and cannot be rerolled. So one more bubotic axe will go down. Twin Heavy Bolter, 6 shots hitting on 5s, getting one hit and five rerolls. And here's the five rerolls, getting one more hit. Strength 5 versus toughness 6. I keep forgetting that Butress and Vitality has gone off, so toughness 6, not toughness 5. Luckily, the heavy plasma cannon was strength 7, so either way it was wounding on a 3. But this means the heavy bolter is only wounding on 5s, not 4s. Getting one miss and one cocked dice. Here's the cocked dice, which still fails to wound. So rerolling both thanks to Gilmon, and gets one wound. Minus one AP, so one four up armor save, which fails. So one five up disgustingly resilient roll, which also fails and cannot be rerolled. So the final bubotic axe will go down. Now the two Hurricane Bolters, 24 shots hitting on fives, getting 8 hits and 16 rerolls. So 16 rerolls, thanks to Gilmon, which only gives them 5 more, for a total of 13 hits. Now, Strength 4 versus Toughness 6, thanks to Putrescent Vitality. I'm gonna try to remember that. Wounding on 5s. And getting 1 wound and 12 rerolls. That is a horrible, horrible dice roll. And here's the reroll. Getting 4 more 6s, but still no 5s. So that is, I would like to point out, that's 25 dice rolls without rolling a single 5. Just so that people can appreciate that. But getting 5 wounds total. 5, 3 up armor saves. And they make all 5 of them. Finally, the two Stormstrike missile launchers onto the Plague Burst Crawler. Hitting on 5s. Getting 1 hit and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll. Getting a second hit. Strength 8 versus toughness 8 means wounding on 4s. Getting 1 wound and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll. Still failing to wound. 1, 5 up invulnerable save, which fails. And it's 3 damage, so 3 5 up disgustingly resilient rolls. Passes 2 of them and fails 1. So the Plague Burst Crawler will drop from 12 starting wounds down to 11. Rabaut Gilmon will now fire his Hand of Dominion in rapid fire range into the Plague Marines. 6 shots hitting on 2s, getting 4 hits and 2 rerolls. And here's the 2 rerolls, getting all 6 hits. Strength 6 versus toughness 6 means 4s to wound, getting 3 wounds and 3 rerolls. And here's the 3 rerolls, getting 5 wounds total, minus 1 AP, so 5 4-up armor saves, passing 2 and failing 3. And these are 2 damage apiece, so we have to do them one at a time. So shot number 1 will kill off a Marine. Shot number 2 will also kill off a Plague Marine. And the third shot will also kill off a Plague Marine. So that is 3 dead Plague Marines. And unfortunately for the Death Guard, they only have the 2 Flails of Corruption and the Champion left, which means that squad is wiped out. The final unit in the Ultramarines army that still needs to shoot is this Storm Raven, the one that's at 12 wounds, and therefore at its highest tier on its damage chart. It is going to fire its 2 Hurricane Bolters and its Twin Heavy Bolter into this squad of Nurgling Swarms, which is within 12 inches. And then it will fire its 2 Storm Strike Missile Launchers and its Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon into this Demon Prince because it is the closest visible enemy unit. So, starting with the 2 Hurricane Bolters, 24 shots hitting on 3s. However, no rerolls since he's not within 6 inches of Gilliman, although they do have 1 command reroll if they wish to use one. Right now, not so much. And so they will get 17 hits out of 24 shots. Strength 4 versus Toughness 2 on the Nurglings means 2s to wound. Getting a couple 1s in there, but getting 13 wounds. 13 5-up invulnerable saves. And they pass 3 of them, failing 10. But luckily for the Nurglings, the Hurricane Bolters only have a damage characteristic of 1, which means they can still take their disgustingly resilient roll. And they pass 4 of those, failing 6. And Nurgling Swarms have 4 wounds apiece, so that will fully kill off 1 Nurgling Swarm, and it will drop a second one down to 2 wounds. But now for the Twin Heavy Bolter, 6 shots hitting on 3s. Ouch, and only getting 2 hits. Strength 5 versus Toughness 2 means 2s to wound. Getting 2 wounds. 2 5-up invulnerable saves, and fails both of them. But they're only 1 damage apiece, so 2 5-up disgustingly resilient rolls. Passes 1, and fails 1. And that means that the injured Nurgling Swarm will go from 2 wounds down to 1, but will stay alive. So now, the 2 Stormstrike Missile Launchers onto the Demon Prince, hitting on 3s, getting 1 hit and 1 miss. Wounding on a 3, and it wounds. Minus 3 AP, so 1 5-up invulnerable save, which passes. Finally, the Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon. Because the Storm Raven does not want to risk taking more wounds on itself, at this time, it will fire standard shots. So 2 D3 shots, getting 3 shots. Hitting on 3s, only getting 1 hit. Strength 7 versus Toughness 6, wounding on a 3, and it wounds. 1 5-up invulnerable save, which fails. But it's only 1 damage, so 1 5-up disgustingly resilient roll, which also fails. So the Demon Prince will fall from 8 starting wounds down to 7. Going into the assault phase for Ultramarines turn 2, we have 3 charges to declare. First is the Centurion Assault Squad is going to declare a multi-charge onto the Malignant Plaguecaster and the Plagueburst Crawler, with the Plagueburst Crawler being the primary target, and it is a 6-inch charge for both units to get into combat with both units. After measuring, the Plagueburst Crawler is slightly closer, about a quarter of an inch closer. But the Plagueburst Crawler will be the primary target of this multi-charge, and the other target will be the Malignant Plaguecaster. Then, the Chaplain is going to declare a multi-charge into the Malignant Plaguecaster, Plague Surgeon, and Tallyman. And then, as long as at least the Centurions make it into combat, which means they would get out of the way, Gilliman will declare a charge only into the Tallyman. And so we will start with the Centurion Assault Squad, which means we will start with Overwatch. So starting with the Heavy Slugger, 4 shots hitting on 6s, rerolling 1s, and getting 1 hit. Strength 5 versus Toughness 5 means wounding on a 4, and it fails to wound. 2 Entropy Cannons hitting on 6s, and they both fail to hit. So now for the charge range from the Centurions, adding 1 thanks to being within 12 inches of Gilliman. and they get a nice 9-inch charge, which means they actually get to charge 10 inches. And so here's where the Centurions ended up, with the two regular Centurions within an inch of the Plague Burst Crawler, and the Centurion Sergeant being within an inch of both the Plague Burst Crawler and the Malignant Plague Caster. So now, of course, we need to resolve the Centurion Assault Launchers. We have 3 dice rolls against the Plague Burst Crawler and 1 dice roll to make against the Malignant Plague Caster. So first, the 3 against the Plague Burst Crawler, looking for 4 ups, and we get 2, so that's 2 mortal wounds. So 2 5-up disgustingly resilient rolls, and fails both of them, and because it's not an infantry, it cannot re-roll the 1. And they also don't want to reroll using a command point because they only have 2 left and they might need that for counteroffensive in this ensuing fight phase, which is why they're not using any command points right now. And they can't reroll the 1 thanks to the Plague Surgeon because it's not an infantry model. So 2 damage will take the Plague Burst Crawler from 11 wounds down to 9. And now for the 1 Centurion Assault Launcher onto the Malignant Plague Caster, looking for a 4, and they get it. So 1 mortal wound, 1 5-up disgustingly resilient roll, which fails with a 2 and therefore cannot be rerolled thanks to the Plague Surgeon. So the Malignant Plague Caster will fall from 4 starting wounds down to 3. I realize I forgot the overwatch from the Malignant Plague Caster. They did need 6 inches to make it within an inch, so they're too far away for a crack grenade, so 1 bolt pistol shot, which would have missed anyways. So the Malignant Plague Caster failed its overwatch against the Centurions after all of that. But now we have the Tallyman and the Plague Surgeon overwatching against the Chaplain, which will attack next. The Tallyman will overwatch with his plasma pistol in supercharged mode, and the Plague Surgeon will have to overwatch with a bolt pistol because the Chaplain is over 6 inches away. So starting with the Tallyman and his plasma pistol with a supercharged shot, hitting on a 6, and it fails to hit. No rerolls. Now the bolt pistol from the Plague Surgeon, that hits, of course, wounding on a 4, and it wounds. 1 3-up armor save, which passes. The Chaplain will also need a 6-inch charge to make it into combat, and he gets it with a 7, which is actually an 8, thanks to Gilliman. And so here's where the Chaplain ends up, within an inch of all 3 character units, but being closest to the Plague Caster, then the Plague Surgeon, and finally the Tallyman. So now Gilliman will charge in, and he needs 8 inches to make it within an inch of the Tallyman. And he makes it with a 10, thanks to his own special ability. And so here's where Gilliman ended up. He is within an inch of the Tallyman. And unfortunately for the Death Guard, now that all the charges have been resolved, of course, now they could heroically intervene if possible. Unfortunately for them, this Demon Prince is just over 3 inches away from Gilliman. This Demon Prince is just over 3 inches away from this Centurion, which means they can't heroically intervene into either of those units because they have to be within 3 inches, not within 3 inches of an inch, but actually within 3 inches. And of course, there's no way that either of these units could move 3 inches in such a way to get within this Chaplain and not be within an inch of any other enemy units. So the Death Guard cannot heroically intervene this turn, which is very unfortunate to them because those Demon Princes would greatly help in close combat. So going into the fight phase, we will start with Gilliman attacking the Tallyman. So Gilliman will put all 6 of his base attacks using the Emperor's Sword onto the Tallyman. 6 attacks, hitting on 2s, getting 5 hits and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll. Getting 6 hits. Strength 8 versus toughness 5 means wounding on 3s. But getting 2 6s, which does an additional D3 mortal wounds apiece, and all 6 actually wounded. So first, the 2 D3 mortal wounds. That'll do 5 mortal wounds, of course. 5 5-up disgustingly resilient rolls. Passes 1, definitely fails 3, and gets 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, which passes, so it only does 3 damage. And so the Tallyman right here will drop from 4 starting wounds down to 1 left. But now we have to resolve the 6 normal wounds from the Emperor's Sword, and it's minus 4 AP, so the Tallyman will not get an armor save, and it's 3 damage apiece. So can the Tallyman make 18 5-up disgustingly resilient rolls? And it definitely cannot. And so now Gilliman will finish off the final wound on the Tallyman, and he is slain. And now that Gilliman is finished, he can consolidate up to 3 inches after killing his target, and Gilliman will end up right here, and he is now in combat with both the Plague Surgeon and this Demon Prince. But Gilliman will not be able to attack anymore in this fight phase. So now, the Death Guard are going to use the stratagem counteroffensive for their final 2 command points. And of course, the Tallyman is slain, which means they cannot get the command points back. So the Death Guard are now officially out of command points. This stratagem is used right after an enemy unit that charges has fought. Select one of your own eligible units and fight with it next. And so it will be the Malignant Plague Caster attacking the Centurions in order to try to kill off one of the models before they get to attack. So, 3 attacks from the Malignant Plague Caster onto the Centurions with his Corrupted Staff. Hitting on 3s, rerolling 1s. And of course, rolling 2 2s. And those can't be rerolled now that the Tallyman has been killed off. Strength 6 versus Toughness 5 means wounding on 3. And it wounds. Minus 1 AP, so 1 3-up armor save, which fails. And since it does D3 damage, the Ultramarines are going to use 1 command point, going from 6 down to 5, for a command reroll in order to reroll that armor save. But first, on a 5-up, do they get the command point back? And they do. So the Ultramarines will stay at 6 command points. Now rerolling the armor save, and passes with a 5, so no damage taken on the Centurions. And so going back to the Ultramarine side, we will now have the Centurion Assault Squad, and they will put all of their attacks onto the Plagueburst Crawler. So, 7 attacks from the squad with their siege drills, hitting on 3s, rerolling thanks to both the Chaplain and Gilliman, and getting 3 rerolls, getting 6 hits. Strength 10 versus Toughness 8 means 3s to wound. Getting 3 wounds and 3 rerolls. And here's the 3 rerolls. Getting 2 more wounds. Minus 4 AP, so 5 5-up and vulnerable saves. And they fail all 5 of them. And they are 3 damage apiece, so 15 5-up disgustingly resilient rolls. And that's a lot of passes, actually. And they passed 7, failing 8. But that does mean that the Plagueburst Crawler will go from 9 wounds down to 1 left and will survive. Finally, on the Ultramarine side, the Chaplain will attack next, and he will place all of his attacks onto the Malignant Plague Caster. So the Chaplain, with his Crozius Arcanum, 3 attacks, hitting on 2s, rerolling 1s thanks to Gilliman and himself. And here's the reroll, and it gets a 3rd hit. Strength 5 versus Toughness 5 means 4s to wound, getting 2 wounds and 2 rerolls. And here's the 2 rerolls. Getting 2 wounds, 1 reroll, and the reroll failed. Minus 1 AP, so 2 4-up armor saves. Passes 1 and fails 1. And it does 2 damage, so 2 5-up disgustingly resilient rolls, and fails both of them. So the Malignant Plague Caster will fall from 3 wounds down to 1. So now that all of the charging Ultramarine units have gone, all that we have left to resolve is the attacks back from the Death Guard, minus the Malignant Plague Caster since he already attacked thanks to counteroffensive. But we have the Plagueburst Crawler attacking the Centurions, and then we will have the Demon Prince of Nurgle and the Plague Surgeon both attacking Gilliman. So, starting with the Plagueburst Crawler onto the Centurions, he's down to 1 wound, so he has 3 attacks, hitting on 6s, and getting 1 hit. Strength 5, thanks to being down to 1 wound, versus Toughness 5 is a 4 to wound, and it wounds. 1 2-up armor save, which passes. Now the Demon Prince of Nurgle, attacking Gilliman. 7 attacks with his 2 sets of Malefic Talents, hitting on 2s, rerolling 1s, 6s generate additional hits. Or additional attacks, I should say. So getting 1 reroll and 1 additional attack. So here's the reroll first, and it gets a hit. And now the additional attack, which will also hit. So 8 hits out of 7 base attacks. Strength 7 versus Toughness 6 is 3s to wound, Ouch, and only getting 3 wounds. This is why rerolls are important. Minus 2 AP, so 3 up and vulnerable saves. And Guillemon passes all 3. So finally, the Plague Surgeon attacking Guillemon. 3 attacks hitting on 3s. And rerolling 1s thanks to the Demon Prince. Here's the 2 rerolls, getting 1 additional hit. Strength 4 versus Toughness 6 means wounding on 5s. And rerolling 1s, but getting 2 wounds. Minus 3 AP, so 2 3 up and vulnerable saves. Passes 1 and fails 1. So Guillemon will fall from 9 wounds down to 8. And now that all of the fights have been resolved, the Ultramarines are going to use the stratagem Honor the Chapter for 3 command points, which will take them from 6 down to 3. Use this stratagem at the end of the fight phase. Select an Adeptus Astartes infantry or Adeptus Astartes biker unit. That unit can immediately fight for a second time. And it will be the Centurion Assault Squad that will fight for a second time. But first, rolling 3 dice, looking for 5 ups to see if they get command points back. And they do not. They fail to get all 3 back, which means the Ultramarines are now permanently down to 3 command points. Since the squad is still fully there, the 2 regular Centurions will place their attacks onto the Plague Burst Crawler, which is 4 attacks total, but the Sergeant, who is also within an inch of the Malignant Plaguecaster, will place his 3 attacks onto the Malignant Plaguecaster. So, starting with the 4 attacks onto the Plague Burst Crawler, hitting on 3s, getting 3 hits and 1 reroll thanks to Guillemon and or the Chaplain. And here's the reroll, getting a 4th hit. Wounding on 3s, getting 2 wounds and 2 rerolls. And here's the 2 rerolls, getting 4 wounds total. 4, 5 up and vulnerable saves. Passes 1, but fails 3. And they are 3 damage apiece, so 9 5 up disgustingly resilient rolls. And making 4 of them, but failing 5, which will take off the last wound and kill the Plague Burst Crawler. But Plague Burst Crawlers can explode on a 5 up, and it will not. It will simply be removed. And so the Plague Burst Crawler loses its last wound and is then removed from the battlefield. Now for the 3 attacks from the Centurion Sergeant onto the Malignant Plaguecaster, hitting on 3s, getting 2 hits and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, getting a 3rd hit. Strength 10 with Siege Drills versus Toughness 5 means 2s to wound, getting 2 wounds and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, getting a 3rd wound. Minus 4 AP, so the Malignant Plaguecaster will not get a save. And they are 3 damage apiece, so 9 5 up disgustingly resilient rolls. Passes 2, but fails 7 with no rerolls, and so that Malignant Plaguecaster is dead. So the Malignant Plaguecaster will lose his final wound, and it will then be removed from the battlefield. And so now, because the Centurions have finished off both of the units that they were in combat with, they will now consolidate up to 3 inches towards the closest enemy unit. And they will finish up like so, which means the Centurion is now within an inch of both the Plague Surgeon and the fully healthy Demon Prince. And so they are now locked in combat all together. And this will mean that the Demon Prince will get a chance to attack the Centurions. So the Demon Prince with 2 sets of Malefic Talons, 7 attacks, hitting on 2s, rerolling 1, 6s generate additional, getting 6 hits and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll, which does hit and also generates an additional attack. So here's the additional attack, which also hits. So just like the slightly wounded Demon Prince, getting 8 hits out of 7 base attacks. Strength 7 versus Toughness 5 means 3s to wound, and getting 5 wounds. Minus 2 AP, so 5 4 up armor saves. And they only fail 1, and it only does 2 damage, which means that the 1 Centurion in the back will go from 3 starting wounds down to 1, and all 3 Centurions are still alive and now locked in combat. Going into the morale phase, this squad of Nurgling Swarms lost 1 model this turn, however they have a leadership of 7, which means it is impossible for them to fail after only losing 1 model. So taking a look at the tactical objective cards, they did successfully complete Overwhelming Firepower for 1 victory point, since they killed 2 units in the shooting phase. If they had finished off either that Nurgling Swarm or the Demon Prince in the shooting phase, they would have been able to roll for D3. But for now, they'll take the 1 victory point. They failed to complete Kingslayer because they did not attack Mortarion at all, but they did kill off at least 3 units total over the course of the turn for no mercy, no respite. And in fact, they actually killed 5 units this turn in total, 3 of which were in the fight phase. So they will get to roll D3, and here's that roll, and it will give them 2 extra victory points. So they will get 2 victory points for no mercy, no respite, and they will hold on to Kingslayer. And so at the end of Ultramarines turn 2, the score currently sits at 5 victory points for the Ultramarines and 0 victory points for the Death Guard. Going into Death Guard turn 2, a reminder that the Death Guard have 0 command points left, and the Ultramarines have 3 command points left. Also, a reminder that the Death Guard held on to Kingslayer and Big Game Hunter from the previous turn. And so they draw 1 new tactical objective card, which is Secure Objective 2. Score 1 victory point if you control Objective Marker 2 at the end of your turn. And Objective Marker 2 is this one right here, currently being controlled by a squad of Tactical Marines. Going into the movement phase for Death Guard turn 2, this squad of Nurgling Swarms is going to remain still. This Demon Prince of Nurgle with Wings will remain locked in combat. This Plague Surgeon will remain locked in combat. This Demon Prince of Nurgle will remain locked in combat. This squad of Nurgling Swarms will remain still. Mortarion is now going to move 12 inches towards the Storm Raven with 12 wounds left. And he will finish his movement right here. So Mortarion's base is now just within 10 inches of the base of the Storm Raven, this one right here, and his body is about 8.5 inches away from the hull. So going into the psychic phase, we will start with Mortarion casting Miasma of Pestilence and Blades of Putrefaction onto himself. Starting with Miasma of Pestilence, which has a warp charge value of 6. And he gets it with a 7. Blades of Putrefaction has a warp charge value of 5. And he gets that with a 7 as well. This Demon Prince will attempt to manifest Smite onto the Centurions. Smite has a warp charge value of 5. And he gets it with a 7. And it will do D3 mortal wounds. And it will do 3 mortal wounds. So that will remove the Centurion that's down to 1 wound. And then a second normal Centurion will go from 3 starting wounds down to 1. Finally, this Demon Prince of Nurgle with Wings will cast Smite onto Gilliman, and it needs a 5, and it gets it with an 8, and it will do D3 mortal wounds, and it will do 2. So Gilliman will fall from 8 wounds down to 6. Going into the shooting phase for Death Guard turn 2, we will have the Plague Surgeon fire his bolt pistol into the Centurion squad to try to finish off the 1 wound. So, 1 bolt pistol shot hitting on a 3, and it hits, wounding on a 5. And it fails to wound. Finally, Mortarion will fire the lantern into this Storm Raven, which is within 18 inches, in an attempt to finish off the final 3 wounds on it. One shot, hitting on a 2, and it hits. Strength 8 versus toughness 7 means wounding on a 3, and it fails to wound, and they have no command points. So going into the assault phase, there's 1 charge to declare, and it is Mortarion declaring a charge onto the Storm Raven with 12 wounds left. And so we will start with Overwatch. Luckily for the Death Guard, Gilliman is about 7 inches away from that Storm Raven, so they will not have full rerolls, but they will still get to reroll hit rolls of 1. So starting with the 2 Hurricane Bolters in Overwatch, 24 shots, hitting on 6s. And rerolling 1s, getting 5 hits and 4 rerolls. And here's the 4 rerolls, still failing to hit. Strength 4 versus toughness 7 means 5s to wound, and getting 2 wounds. 2 3 up armor saves, passes 1 and fails 1. 1 5 up disgustingly resilient roll, which also fails. So Mortarion will fall from 18 starting wounds down to 17. 6 shots from the Twin Heavy Bolter, hitting on 6s, rerolling 1s, getting 1 hit and 2 rerolls. And here's the 2 rerolls, getting 1 more hit. Strength 5 versus toughness 7 means 5s to wound, and failing to wound. 2 Storm Strike Missile Launchers, hitting on 6s, rerolling 1s, and getting 1 hit. Strength 8 versus toughness 7 means wounding on a 3, and it fails to wound. Finally, the Twin Heavy Plasma Cannon will fire standard shots. 2 D3 shots, getting 4 shots. Hitting on 6s, rerolling 1s, getting one hit and two rerolls. And here's the two rerolls, still failing to hit. Strength 7 versus toughness 7 means a 4 to wound, and it wounds. 1 4 up in vulnerable save, and it fails, and it does 1 damage, so 1 disgustingly resilient, which passes. But now Mortarion will charge in. And he fails with a 4, and they have no command points, so they cannot reroll it. So that is a definite failed charge. And so, going into the fight phase, we have 3 units from each side locked in combat that needs to be resolved. And it will go back and forth, starting with the Death Guard, since it is their turn. So we will first do this Demon Prince onto these 2 Centurions. 7 attacks, hitting on 2s, rerolling 1s, 6s generate additional attacks. And we have 5 hits with an additional attack and 2 rerolls. First, here's the 2 rerolls, both getting a hit, and of course one of them gets an additional attack. So now 2 additional attacks hitting on 2s, and both of those hit. So getting 9 hits out of 7 base attacks. Strength 7 versus toughness 5 means wounding on 3s. And getting 7 wounds. Minus 2 AP, so 7 4-up armor saves. And they pass 4, but fail 3. And so the Ultramarines are going to use 1 command point for a command reroll, going from 3 down to 2, in order to reroll the 3. But first, do they get the command point back on a 5-up? And they do not. So the Ultramarines are now permanently down to 2 command points. And so here's the 1 reroll. And it passes, only failing 2. And that is extremely important, because the Malefic Talons do 2 damage apiece. But unfortunately, the damage does not carry over, which means the first strike, which does 2 damage, simply removes the 1 wound from the wounded Centurion, which means that only 1 strike goes on to the Sergeant, taking him from 3 wounds down to 1, which means that the Sergeant survives. And this way, he will now attack back. So 3 attacks from the Sergeant onto the Demon Prince. Hitting on 3s, getting 3 hits. Wounding on 3s, getting 2 wounds and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll. Getting a 3rd wound. 3, 5 up in vulnerable saves. And they fail all 3. And they are 3 damage apiece, so 9, 5 up disgustingly resilient rolls. Wow, passing 5 and failing 4. But that is significant, because that will drop the fully healthy Demon Prince from 8 starting wounds down to 4. So now the other Demon Prince will attack Guillemon. 7 attacks, hitting on 2s, rerolling 1s, 6s generate additional, getting 6 hits and 1 reroll. And here's the reroll. Still failing to hit, so getting 6 hits out of 7 base attacks. Strength 7 versus toughness 6 means wounding on 3s. And getting 3 1s, so only getting 3 wounds. 3, 3 up in vulnerable saves, and passes all 3 of them. And so now Guillemon will attack next. And Guillemon has 6 attacks base, so he will place 3 attacks with the Emperor's Sword onto the Demon Prince, and 3 attacks onto the Plague Surgeon, since he's within an inch of both. So starting against the Plague Surgeon, 3 attacks, hitting on 2s, and getting 3 hits. Strength 8 versus toughness 5 means 3s to wound, getting 1 wound and 2 rerolls. And here's the 2 rerolls, getting 2 more wounds, and there's 2 6s in there, which do D3 automatic mortal wounds. So 2 D3 automatic mortal wounds, which will do 3. 3, 5 up disgustingly resilient rolls. Passes 1, but fails 2. So that will drop the Plague Surgeon from 4 wounds down to 2, and the separating plate does not reflect wounds back, because that only affects saving throws, and disgustingly resilient is not a saving throw. But because he was not killed off by mortal wounds, now he will have a chance to reflect back wounds with his armor save, and thanks to the separating plate, he has a 2 up armor save, and the Emperor's Sword is minus 4 AP, so 3 6 up armor saves. And fails all 3 of them. 3 damage apiece, so 9 5 up disgustingly resilient rolls. Passed 1, 1 reroll, 7 definite fails. And the Plague Surgeon is killed off and removed. And this does mean that the Chaplain is no longer locked in combat. So now, the three attacks with the Emperor's Sword onto the Demon Prince. Hitting on twos, rerolling ones. Hitting one hit and two rerolls. And here's the two rerolls, getting just one more hit. Wounding on threes, getting one hit, which will also do D3 mortal wounds, and one reroll. And here's the reroll, still getting a one, so still failing to wound. But first, D3 automatic mortal wounds, and it will do just one. What is with all of the ones all of a sudden? So one mortal wound onto the Demon Prince, one 5-up disgustingly resilient, which fails. So the Demon Prince will fall from 7 wounds down to 6 left. And so now the normal wound against the Emperor's Sword, one 5-up invulnerable save, which fails, and that does an automatic 3 damage, so 3 disgustingly resilient rolls. Passes 1, but failing 2. And so the Demon Prince will drop from 6 wounds down to 4 left, which means now that both Demon Princes are down to 4 wounds. And the Plague Surgeon is now dead, so it cannot attack, and the Chaplain will remain out of combat and not consolidate in. So going to the morale phase, the Centurion squad lost 2 models this turn. However, thanks to being an Ultramarine, the Sergeant has a leadership of 9, which means it's impossible to fail a morale check after losing 2 models. So he will remain alive and in combat. So taking a look at the tactical objective cards, the Death Guard failed to complete Kingslayer, they failed to complete Big Game Hunter, and they failed to secure Objective 2. And they will throw secure Objective 2 away. And so at the end of Death Guard turn 2, the score currently sits at 0 victory points for the Death Guard and 5 victory points for the Ultramarines. And at this point, the Death Guard are going to concede the game. So we will have a final score of 5-0 because the Storm Raven is in flying mode and cannot achieve Linebreaker. So no Linebreaker, no Slay the Warlord for either side. So we have a major victory thanks to a concession in favor of the Ultramarines and a final score in terms of victory points of 5-0 in favor of the Ultramarines. So now that the game is over and it's been announced that the Ultramarines have achieved a major victory thanks to concession with a final score of 5 victory points to 0 in the Ultramarines' favor, I can go over one or two of my final thoughts and I will try to keep this short and sweet. First of which is the main reason for why the Death Guard conceded at this point, and I think it's pretty obvious based off of how the battle has gone through these first 2 game turns, but the Death Guard have had horribly bad luck in this game in pretty much all aspects, from their dice rolls to drawing tactical objective cards to their opponents passing saving throws more than they should have. The fact that the Centurion Sergeant is still alive is actually a miracle if we think about it. The fact that Gilliman still has 6 wounds remaining is just incredible. The fact that both Storm Ravens are still alive, with of course the Storm Raven that still has 12 wounds and is therefore at full shooting capacity, remember that still has a full healthy squad of Centurions and another Chaplain embarked inside of it. So if we were to play out Ultramarines turn 3, this is exactly what would happen. Centurions and Chaplain would disembark from the Storm Raven within 3 inches, but then move up 4 to be within easy charge range of Mortarion. They would shoot all 6 of their flamers at Mortarion, automatically hitting, so they don't care about Miasma of Pestilence. Also, the Storm Raven would drop into hover mode and reposition itself slightly so that it's within 6 inches of Gilliman, and then unleash everything it has on Mortarion. Most likely, Mortarion would be dead this turn. And of course, this Storm Raven is still alive with 3 wounds, so while it's at the lowest tier of its damage chart, it could reposition itself a little bit so that it is once again within 6 inches of Gilliman, and make sure that it's within 12 inches of Mortarion so that he can fire everything that he has at Mortarion. And of course, if 3 healthy Centurions charge into Mortarion with all of their siege drills, and if they position themselves properly, I mean, they will get rerolled hits from the Chaplain, but if they position themselves properly, most likely not, but there is a slight chance that they could remain within 6 inches of Gilliman as well for reroll failed wound rolls. So pretty much Mortarion and the Death Guard, I should say just the Death Guard because that's the army, they have 5 units left on the table, 2 of which are Nurgling Swarms, 2 of which are half-dead Demon Princes, and of course 1 Mortarion, whereas the Ultramarines have most of their firepower from the start of the game left, although some of it's slightly injured. The biggest difference and the easiest way to look at it is here's the Death Guard dead pile, including six fully dead units, thanks to these three characters dying off, and here's the Ultramarines dead pile. The Death Guard failed to kill off a single full unit this game in two turns, and considering the fact that they're down to the firepower that they are, they most likely won't kill off a single full unit. Because if they really wanted to preserve themselves, obviously this Centurion Sergeant could fall back, and thanks to being an Ultramarine, he can still shoot. So he could fall back, fire both Flamers into the Demon Prince, then the Chaplain fires into the Demon Prince. Guillemot is not in base to base with this Demon Prince, which means he could pile in up to 3 inches and actually get into combat with both, and then be able to attack both, and most likely kill both of them off, because that's what would happen, knowing the Ultramarines. So pretty much the Death Guard are on their last legs at the end of turn two with very little firepower and a really good chance of being within a game turn of being tabled. So that's why the Death Guard conceded. There's no point in having them suffer anymore. Like I mentioned earlier, just terrible luck when drawing tactical objective cards. The fact that at the end of game turn two, the Death Guard have zero victory points is just, it's a bad omen, and most likely they would not catch up, because at this point, the Ultramarines, they can draw two new tactical objective cards, and they have Kingslayer, of course, so if they kill Mortarion, they get Slay the Warlord, they get Kingslayer. Just bad news all around for the Death Guard, and the Ultramarines kind of ran away with the victory. So that's why they conceded. That's pretty much how the game went. From my perspective, it was a fun game to play. It was interesting. There were interesting dice rolls, a couple of crazy happenings. It was a pretty fast-paced game, which is always good. It keeps things interesting if it's moving quickly and doesn't feel like it's bogged down in a war of attrition. So overall, I thought it was fun to play. I hope it was fun to watch, and stay tuned for the next one.